Hey folks, Rich here at RRC Informer. Today I have the definitive build guide on the LX Models F4 Phantom 2 from Banana Hobby. This really is one sweet jet. It's such an iconic model from the Vietnam War era, and LX Models has really come a long way. They have some of the most unique models out there, but in most cases they usually seem to have one or two items on the airplane that just need some tweaking. And then it becomes really a stellar model. And this airplane is no exception. Now, it is very ruggedly built, has a super nice paint job, probably has some of the best landing gear around, all ball bearing supported with brakes, all aluminum and steel. Just really nice stuff. Building the plane, as you saw from the flying video, it flies great, but building the airplane is really very simple. You only glue a few things on it. You do glue the back section of the tail on, you glue the tail cones on, a little bit of glue on the nose cone, and aside from that, the wings really just sort of bolt on. The stabilators just screw on with a single screw in the back, and the vertical stabilizer just sort of bolts into position as well. Now, aside from putting your ordnance package on the airplane if you want the missiles and the drop tanks on there, that's about it. You put your receiver battery and you go. Now, that being said, there are a lot of things that I have for you guys in this setup guide that's going to really help you get it going. I have some suggestions for the speed controllers underneath, how to get them to cool a little better, some suggestions for gluing that tail on so it's a little more durable. And of course, the slat system. I know a lot of guys have been complaining about them. Some guys have glued them in position and not use them at all, but they really do help the airplane slow down quite a bit. And as you saw from the video, and you can see right here, my slats are working fantastic after some tweaking. And once you get them set up and working right, this really is a tremendously nice airplane. And the flaps and slat system really do help slow the airplane down a bit. It takes off at a slower speed. It lands at a slower speed too, so they're really quite functional once you get them tweaked and set up right. And I'm going to show you that here in this video. Now, this is just a simple six-channel airplane, guys. Ailerons, elevator, rudder and nose wheel steering, of course, throttle, flaps and slats, and retractable landing gear and wheel brakes. Now, you do need a seventh channel for the wheel brakes. So as long as you have a separate seventh channel to operate that, they come on and off. Which leads me to the next tip I'm going to show you in the video, is to get the brakes to function right. They generally work nicely out of the box, but sometimes they tend to lock up a little bit and brake too severely. So I'm going to show you three ways in which you can adjust them so the plane actually decelerates nicely. Overall, this is just a super nice airplane, as you saw from the flying video. And this setup and build guide is going to show you how to get yours flying just as nicely. So without further delay, guys, let's get on to the build and setup guide of the LX Models F4 Phantom 2 from Banana Hobby. The first thing I did with the bottom of my Phantom was to remove the access cover here for the speed controllers. Just two screws will remove this and it comes off really easily. I had noticed in the instruction manual that they had taped both speed controllers together, and that really didn't seem to be a great idea because both speed controllers get really hot, and having them stuck right together is going to get them both even hotter. So you can see here I put a piece of balsa wood just right between the two of them with a little bit of Velcro attached to both of them. And you can see here in this picture what that, I'll put a picture up here to show you what that block looks like. And then I just re-taped them together. Really it's a good idea to separate them again so they don't get too hot. You want to use something that's non-conductive, so you know, cardboard, balsa wood, something. And also you want to secure everything so it doesn't get sucked into the intakes. All the intakes for the left engine run through here, right engine run through here, and you want to make sure everything's secure so nothing gets pulled in there. But putting something non-conductive and that separates the two of these things apart so they each get plenty of cooling and they're not heating each other up is a really good idea. Also, you can see here I put Velcro down on the whole package to sort of Velcro this thing to the bottom to keep it in place. And also, before you do all this stuff, what I did with mine is I took this heat shrink wrap with a hobby knife. I just cut around here and removed it from this heat sink side because you want this heat sink to be open. You really don't want this heat shrink wrapping to be impeding this heat sink from doing its cooling job. So anyway, you can see this Velcros in here really nicely. It'll help keep these things a lot cooler. Everything's in the free stream of air. And like I said, just as a summary, it's a good idea to separate the two of those and secure them in place so they stay and they run nice and cool. Then you can just put your hatch cover on and move on. The assembly process for the Phantom is actually really simple. There's only a few little things that you really have to use contact cement to glue in place. You glue a couple brackets onto the nose cone to get the nose cone on. These little ordnance clips, if you want to put your ordnance, drop tanks, bombs on the airplane, you just contact cement these little clips in place, and you can remove or add the ordnance as you want to. So this is a really nice nice design. But the major part of the gluing really just comes down to actually gluing the tail assembly onto the back of the plane right here. And the other thing you glue on really is the tail cones, okay? And there's also a little mark right here, a little detent right here at the top that lines up with this detent right here. And it tells you exactly which way these go on. Now, there's a couple different ways you can glue these on. You can use contact cement if you want to. I prefer to use epoxy, as everybody knows. And it's a good idea to remove all the paint first. You can see here I removed all the paint here from the areas that that are going to contact each other. I also removed it around here again from the ring where the tail cone is going to go. You can see here I already started removing it already. And the easiest way really to remove that I've found here lately, that I've been using this new method that actually one of my viewers suggested, but I'm actually using packing tape for this. And really you can just put the packing tape sort of right on any painted surface here, and boom, it just takes it all off. Now, even though you do this to get the paint off, if you're going to use epoxy especially, you really want to scuff this surface with some sandpaper and make it rough. You can see how this side right here, I've removed all the paint from here, and I'm going to scuff it here next, and then I'm going to remove all this paint and scuff that as well. Most of the plane, you put, like you can see right here, you put a Y harness on for the elevators and feed that through the hole. And then again, 30-minute epoxy to glue this thing on, and then either 30-minute epoxy or contact cement to glue your cones on. Now, when you glue these cones on, again, removing the paint here, you want to make sure these are pretty secure because there's a lot of pressure coming out of these holes. And during flight, I've had in the past with other jets, these cones get blown off in flight. So and that changes the whole thrust line, because you can see there's a slight down angle in these cones. So it's real critical with these two Phantom cones, you make sure these things are very well glued in position, whether you use epoxy or whether you use contact cement. And again, if you use epoxy, make sure you scuff this so the epoxy has something to bond to. But overall, gluing this Phantom together is very, very simple. At some point in assembling your airplane, when you get the nose cone on, there are these two little plastic catches on this side and on this side that were intended to keep the nose cone on. But as you can see in this video, I found that it really isn't secure enough. You can see where the nose cone actually came off on the takeoff. And that basically warrants gluing it or taping it on. You can see I put a little black piece of electrical tape on here. You can see my nose cone got a little scuffed from that takeoff. But never fear, if your nose cone comes off, as you can see in the video here, the plane still flies fine. It's just a little more draggy, so just be careful flying it and just land it again and put the nose cone back on. But it's a real good idea to either put some tape on the top and the bottom, or use a little contact cement to glue this on, which is what I ended up doing with mine. But do it before you fly it so it doesn't come off and get damaged. Wait until you balance the airplane too before you glue the nose cone on, because I put a little bit of nose weight in the front of here, which I'll show you a little later, an ounce and a half really, right on the shelf in here. And it's easier getting that weight in there when the nose cone is not glued on. But bottom line is, just make sure you do use some additional security, even if you decide to install magnets in here and just have your nose cone secured with additional magnets in place is even a good idea. But don't just rely on these two plastic clips in there, because I found that mine came off with those. One tip I have for everybody regarding the Phantom, and really it's applicable to any airplane that you have, and I do this with all of my airplanes when I first get them, especially one that it's mostly one color, gray like this, is I have the paint matched. And what I do is I take a piece of the airplane, in this case I took the top cover, which is mostly gray. I took it over to Lowe's, and I had Lowe's in their paint department for $3. They will perfectly match and mix some gray paint for you, so you can touch up your airplane at any time. White is usually always white, black is usually black, but the odd colors, like this particular shade of gray, is a perfect match. And then labeling. You see, I put LXF4 Phantom on there. What had happened for me too is when I was working on the slats, I ended up dropping a little bit of, actually quite a bit of a CA accelerator on the wing, and actually all the paint came off this portion of the wing right here, and you can't even tell because I mixed, I had this paint, I put it in an airbrush and sprayed right over it, and you can't even tell. So it's a great way to maintain your models, to always have that matching color. And for $3, you just, you can't go wrong at Lowe's mixing, getting some exterior or interior wall paint like this to match your model perfectly. One of the most critical factors in getting any airplane to fly well is getting the CG correct, especially in a swept wing fighter plane like the F4 Phantom. The book calls for 194 millimeters aft of the leading edge, where the leading edge meets the fuselage. And I found that I didn't fly it here. I think if you fly it at this mark, you'll probably be lucky to get the airplane back in one piece on your first takeoff. I think it's just too far aft. I used 180 millimeters because I realized a bunch of guys online were actually using 180 and having some pretty good success with it. So as we take a look at the CG here with my little ruler on here, as I put this up against the fuselage, line up the ruler there with the leading edge, you can see that 180 gets us right about here, just behind where this wing panel line actually meets the fuselage. Now, flying it there, I even found that that was a little bit unstable for me. I felt that the airplane was pitching up and down quite a bit. So ultimately, after flying my airplane around quite a bit and moving my battery farther forward, or if you need to, you can add nose weight, I ultimately found that actually if you measure 160 millimeters from the leading edge, where the leading edge meets the fuselage back, seems to be the best really position to fly this airplane at, right at 160. Now the manual said 195, which was really far back here somewhere. But to simplify things, sometimes the leading edge of the wings get a little dented up in the box and it's a little bit of an ambiguous location. What I think really works best is if you just use the panel line right here, and if you measure right where this this diagonal line from the wing meets the fuselage, and then go forward about 10 millimeters, that is like the perfect spot. And again, that translates to about 160 millimeters aft the leading edge, where leading edge meets the fuselage, which puts it right about here. So anyway, that seems to fly my airplane best, guys, right at 160 millimeters. Now, when you do balance your airplane where that wing panel line meets the fuselage, just a little bit ahead of that, when I balanced mine, I actually did do it with the landing gear down at the flying field with my fingers, with the airplane balancing upside down. With the airplane right side up, this plane's very top heavy because it's a low wing airplane and all the weight is up here. If you try and balance it right side up with a balancer or with your fingers on the bottom of the airplane, it just teeters too much and it doesn't really have that pendulum effect. Whereas when the airplane's upside down, it does balance well and it pendulums pretty nicely. So ultimately, you really want to balance this airplane with the landing gear in the up position. Just because the nose wheel actually swings aft, and that actually sets the CG farther back when you retract the landing gear. It's not a big deal. I did do mine with the wheels down at that mark with the plane upside down, holding it on my fingers at the flying field, and I got real great results out of that. While we're on the subject of center of gravity, I thought I'd show you how I balance the airplane out well. A couple things to note up here in the nose cone. When the nose comes off, you can see right here I added 1.5 ounces of weight up front here. You don't have to do this if your battery is heavy enough and small enough and you can shift it far enough forward to get the CG that you need that we just talked about, around 170 millimeters or so. So you don't necessarily need the nose weight, but that is a really great place to put it up front there before you glue the nose cone on. You can still reach it from here, but it's just easier to install it there. Now, regarding the battery, a couple items I'm going to show you here about it. I had to shift it significantly farther forward. It's a good way to, it's a good idea to put it in the way I have it here, where the leads go back here. You can connect all your leads and put them all down in there. And then your rear cover, hatch cover goes on here, your main hatch cover goes down here. And you don't have to worry about wires coming over the front part of the battery here. But you can see here that I added a little bit of foam here. I also put at the flying field, I put a big wad of actually just cardboard, something I had sitting around because I was at the field doing this. But really you need to put enough weight in here, or enough spacers in here really, so the battery gets the proper position that it needs. Also, you can see that I actually had to cut away the foam right here a little bit to get the battery to sit far enough down in. And then I cut little by little out of the front here. You can see these two wires down in there for the nose wheel. I had to actually remove those first before you start cutting into this. And then once you're done cutting, put the wires back down into that trench. Otherwise, you will cut those wires. But you can see I had to cut this area out. I put a little bit of non-skid shelf liner here to keep the battery from sliding around. You can see it down in here. But getting the battery in, once you find your position where you need it, and you need it far enough forward again to get the right CG, you really just put the battery in this way. Now, with my airplane, they did seem to put enough glue on these straps, and I kind of trusted them. I pulled up on these straps just to make sure they were secure enough, because I fly my airplane upside down, as you saw in the video, fly it inverted a bit, and you do want these straps to be on there definitely plenty tight if you're going to do that. So you take a good tug on all four of these. It looked like they glued it in on mine really nicely and really didn't have any problems with it. Now, getting these battery straps on was a little bit of a challenge, but once you get the technique down, it's actually not bad. What I did is I used a ruler or just something flat like this, because you really can't feed the Velcro down there because it tries to stick on itself. So you need something, a piece of plastic or a ruler like this, so they don't stick together. And then you can push this end of it here, the actual hook part down in there, far enough, and then you pull your ruler out, and then you can strap this thing down nice and tight, and then you can actually use this end to push it down in. Same thing on both of these. Again, you need something to run interference, something smooth like this, so you can feed this part of the strap down in there. And this is the technique I use for mounting this type of battery, and it works really nicely. It gets the battery nice and secure, it gets everything out of the way, and it's just a really good way to get your battery in nice and secure. And with that little trench up front there, it keeps the battery from sliding forward or back. That little shelf liner I put down there also keeps it from sliding forward and back, and you have a really nice, secure battery. Just make sure you take a tug on your straps, because they're glued at the factory occasionally. Sometimes they don't put quite so much glue on there, but they did a great job gluing this one in, and it's nice and secure in my airplane like this. Two things they got right on this airplane for sure is getting the hatch covers set up right. They put this little tab here so you can pull your front hatch cover off. It's a tongue and groove up front with these little latch mechanisms here. It could benefit from maybe two magnets right here and then right here to attach, but I hadn't had any problems flying the airplane and having this thing come off. So it seems to have worked out really nice in their design. Also, the rear hatch comes off real nice. Now, right from the factory, these were just beautifully installed, and everything just went on really nice. So definitely thumbs up on the hatch design on this airplane. It just makes getting the airplane in and out of it real easy. Just a few items to note about the top hatch cover, where all the electronics are. Just to give you an idea of the format here, you can see my two antennas, one horizontal and one sort of lined up with the longitudinal axis, just taped in place. They're 90 degrees to each other, so that really reduces the chance of interference. Receiver, my Futaba 8-channel receiver, I just Velcroed right in. Landing gear control module, you can see right here, just Velcroed in as well. Up top here, we've got the brake controller board. Again, that's Velcroed in. And something to take note of that I'll probably talk about a little bit later on here is there is a potentiometer on here, and you rotate this with a small screwdriver to adjust the voltage that goes to the brakes. And you want to make sure this is really at the minimum setting to allow the brakes to function. If they're up too high and you apply the brakes too much, or too often, I should say, they will heat up and burn out. And I did this a few times and I actually didn't even know that this potentiometer was here. So you can adjust the voltage to your brakes, and that's one way that you can adjust how much power goes to the brakes and how quickly or how slowly the airplane decelerates. So I found myself turning it down. If you go all the way down to the lowest setting, if you apply your brakes, sometimes there's not enough voltage to activate both brakes and you only activate one. So you want to turn it up enough that you do get both brakes coming on. And that's really one of the first adjustments and one of the easiest. You don't want to apply your brakes more than a few times within a few minutes because they can overheat again and burn out, which I actually did on a few of mine. The other item I want to show you in here too, I went ahead and removed the factory BEC. It was working okay. But this is kind of a no-name one. I've had kind of trouble with some of these things, and in a lot of the other planes like the YF-23, the big B-25 that LX makes, it's not a bad idea to use a separate receiver battery or a BEC. So I use these Castle BECs for a lot of my stuff. You can either solder it in, or like I did, I just use one of these red connectors, and that way you can actually transfer it from one model to the other. This is a real good way to go. All the flight demos you've seen, I'm using this BEC. I think eventually LX Models is going to be going over to Hobbywing BEC, so they'll hopefully in the future be a little bit better than using this standard one. But for another $24 or so, whatever these BECs cost, it's just some added security, and you know that the airplane's going to function so much better with either a separate BEC from Castle or just using a separate receiver battery, and you'll know you always have real good control of the airplane. Here's a quick look at the main landing gear. I just wanted to show you the quality of this. You can see the steel trunnions down in here, all aluminum struts, all ball bearing supported wheels, and just tremendous suspension. LX has really gone a long way with their landing gear, and they're actually now starting to have some of the best landing gear in the business. I'm just really impressed with it. Now, as I move on here to one of the wheels here to show you the brakes, you can see how these things are ball bearing supported. As I spin this and I hit the brake switch, it locks them up. Now, the wheels don't lock. They actually have a deceleration rate. But as we saw from the electronics compartment up front or up on the top of the airplane, you want to adjust the voltage or adjust that potentiometer all the way to its lowest point, so it's putting out the lowest amount of power, and then slowly turn it up so you get both brakes coming on. If you have it too low, again, only one brake will come on and the other one will not, but you don't want to have it too high. So start at the bottom, slowly move it up, hitting the brake switch until not just one engages, but both brakes engage, because you don't want to have one come on and the other one not. That's the first thing you want to do to adjust your brakes. The second thing you want to do to adjust your brakes is these two screws. And what I found with my brakes is that they were decelerating the airplane way too quickly. So in order to stop that deceleration rate, you actually have to turn these two screws inward quite a bit. And mine, I went almost to the full amount. Yours may be a little bit different. But by tightening those screws or moving them in and compressing those springs, It then prohibits the electromagnet from moving too far in, actually, and engaging the brake. So that's another way to adjust it. Now, the third way to adjust your brake is to actually sand the face of the actual brake down. Now, this is the actual electromagnet that actually fits inside this, and it actually goes in just like this. You can see where those screw holes go in, and this thing basically goes in when the brake activates. And it actually hits a skid plate right here, and that's what makes it break. So in order to prevent it from contacting too much, what I found was is taking a sanding bar and very lightly just sand away the edge of this. I use a thicker grit sandpaper, and then towards the end I use a finer grit sandpaper and sand it down so this area is nice and smooth. Now you want to do this last if the potentiometer is not working, breaking or over breaking the airplane. And by turning these screws in, you still can't get the wheels to decelerate the airplane slowly. Then this was the last resort, and it worked quite well. Start with a little bit of coarse sandpaper, then a little bit of fine sandpaper. Make sure this thing is smooth. You can reinstall this thing in there by taking the wheel off and putting it through. And I found by making this flatter and smoother, my brakes actually don't lock up on the runway anymore. So it's just one last way that you can get into it. And again, you want to be very careful. Just sand away a little bit. It's just plastic and metal, and there's an electromagnet. There's coils wrapped around in here. But this is the actual braking surface right here. Again, this goes in and it contacts the metal surface of the wheel, and the wheel actually slides on this part. So just flattening this up, making it smooth, will actually reduce the braking of the airplane just a little bit. A few items to note regarding the fans on this airplane. This is kind of an older style of fan, but it's still a very good fan. This is one of the ways they do keep the cost down by not having a very expensive fan in the airplane. But after a few flights, my plane started making a little noise, and I assumed that these four screws were loosening, and they were. It just happens sometimes with these things. They had actually not put enough or had put really any blue Loctite on these four screws. So I had to pull both fans out of the airplane, get these screws out, and then just reinstall them with a little bit of blue Loctite. It was a little bit of pain getting them out because they do glue them in, okay, with some contact cement. And you can just pry it away and it'll break free like this, and you put a little more glue on when you put them back in just to keep them in there. But if it starts making a funny or scraping noise, that's probably what it is. These fans have been used on a lot of different airplanes, this particular model of fan, and it does happen. Now, you can see the access hatch there. There's screws here, and actually, unfortunately, the wing has to be removed. You have to pull the wing off. And then there's some screws on the side, on the top side of the fuselage, so you can get in here. And then both fans are actually just sitting right down in here where you can pry them out. Anyway, just make sure they don't loosen up. If they do, again, you'll have to pull them out, put a little blue Loctite on those, on the threads, on the metal threads in there, and then it's nice and secure. The whole flight demo you saw was really conducted. Most of it was done after I put these on, and it was just whisper smooth, not loose at all. Maybe it was just my airplane too that they just forgot maybe to put the Loctite on there. But in many instances, I have found that on a lot of airplanes that use this 70 millimeter fan, that they don't put enough, or they don't put any Loctite on there. Now, one more thing I want to talk about that's of great concern. Not a big deal, but the YF-23 has these same fans, and a lot of the LX twin 70 millers have these same fans. And they have this little plastic spinner cone on here. And they're relatively aerodynamic, I guess. And they literally just screw right on here. But in many cases in the past, zooming down the runway, I ingest a bug or something. Or this plastic is really not too tough. It really needs to be an aluminum cone. And it can shatter. And then all those pieces go into the fan blade disintegrates, and now you don't have an engine anymore. The other fan is the only one that's driving the plane. So when this got loose and I took the fans out of the airplane, I just went ahead and removed the spinner cone, and I didn't put the spinner cone back in. I just tightened this up, and I fly my airplanes mostly like this without the spinner cone, because this plastic spinner cone, I believe, is a source of coming apart and getting in the fan and kind of destroying the thing. It doesn't create that much aerodynamic, effect that it really is going to affect this fan much. And actually, most of the flight demo you saw was without the cone on there. So it's not a bad idea if you have to get in there. Just unscrew the cone and leave it off, and the plane flies great without it. And it's just one less source of trouble that can take out a fan. So it's a good idea just to leave it out. One thing you do want to do to your ailerons, your flaps, and your rudder clevises is to put a piece of fuel tubing on them. You can see here I added these. These were not something that came on the airplane. I would have put them on the elevator as well, but they're so buried deep into the tail of the airplane, and adding fuel tubing to them would possibly make them bind. But for the remainder of the flight controls, again, ailerons, flaps, and rudder, put some fuel tubing on those, and it'll really just add a little extra security to the model. Drum roll, please. Here's a quick look at the slap mechanism on the F4 Phantom, and you can see how nicely they work once you do get them tweaked. Now, I had many issues with them. Mostly it was just a lot of play and slop in the system, like everybody's reported. I mostly found that the flaps really didn't have a place where they locked in position. They sort of would just float and move around a little bit, and they really didn't have any defined stopping point. And if you have a flap or slat asymmetry, which means that some of them come out, one side comes out farther than the other, well, that will cause the airplane to roll. Same thing with the flaps. If one flap comes down, the other one doesn't come down, it'll cause the airplane to roll. We call that an asymmetry from one side to the other, meaning both sides are not the same. So in order to keep these things going out, at both of them extending the same amount, I had to put some stoppers on them. Another thing I noticed, and I'm going to show you how to do that, the other thing I noticed too is that this rod right here, running along here, was sloppy moving forward and back. And I had to find a way to get rid of the play in there. Now, one of the things I'm going to start with that I'm going to show you, because I made so many changes to the system as I was tweaking it, I don't remember where some of the things started off at. So just to show you the holes where the slats actually plug into, you can see I use the outer hole here and the inner hole here, and I actually ended up putting a drop of CA in each one of them very carefully without getting it stuck in the servo. You don't want it to go in there. And that filled in the gap, so it made it got rid of the play that was in there. I believe I did the same thing right here too. You can see how there's a little bit of play there. If you put a little CA in some of these, you can stop that play from happening, because it doesn't really stick to the metal, but it sticks to the plastic in most cases. Anyway, those are the holes I started off with. One of the first things I did to get the slop out of these things is, one of the first things I did was, I made sure that all of these screws, because there's so many screws here, I made sure they were all tightened enough. Some of them were not tightened all the way, and it made the thing, you know, move around side to side quite a bit. And by tightening them all just a little bit without making them bind, you can get rid of some play right off the bat. Now let me show you some of the special things I did to really eliminate the play on this airplane for the slats. Now, some of the items that I used starting off were really a whole bunch of these little nylon washers that I get at the local surplus place. And with some flush cutters, you can see here what I did. I went ahead and I cut some of these things, if I can get this thing under control. With a flush cutter, I just cut a little notch out of them. And you may need ones that are different thicknesses, but I have a whole bunch of these, like you can see here. Again, I get these at the Skycraft Surplus here in Orlando. But anyway, you need some nylon washers. Cut the little notch in there. I'm going to show you what I'm going to do with those. Also, I used the other next component I used was just a little bit of carbon rod or carbon rectangle stock here. And you can see the actual size that I used right here from GravesRC.com. This size seemed to work well. You don't have to use this size, as you're about to see what I'm going to show you I did with it. But you just need to have the same size block for all the slats, so the slats will stop in the same place. I also use this 1/64th or 0.4 millimeter aircraft birch. It's the really thin stuff that you can really just cut with scissors. It's almost like paper. And I'll show you what I did with that as well. But once you have these components, you could see where I eliminated the play in the slat system here, which I'll show you. Now, by taking these nylon washers that we actually cut a notch out of, very carefully, you can insert some of them into right onto this shaft, because you can't really take this whole shaft apart with all the bell cranks on it and everything, but you can insert some of these washers. So by pushing some of these washers straight down on here, which you can see one right in there, you get rid of a lot of that sort of side-to-side play. And you can see there is some play in it. You're going to have a little bit. But look how much it's moving now. It was really moving before. And by just putting that washer in there and putting a few washers in wherever you need it, now you can see down here, this needed quite a bit. There were actually two washers down here on this end. That really allowed me, again, to get rid of a whole ton of slop. Now you can also see I put one right here, because this whole thing was moving around big time. Now you can see I do have some play in here, but it had a whole lot more without that washer in there. So these washers really served a huge purpose for getting rid of some of the play. Also, where this Z-bend went in, you can see I added the washer there. Now you can see there is still play in this thing, but there was even more without that washer in there. So I actually used a little bit of CA and glued that nylon washer. I think I sanded one side of the nylon washer so the CA would stick to it better. The CA sticks to the plastic quite nicely. You just want to be careful not to get CA in these little arms here. It's a little bit of delicate surgery to do this. But if you get CA in these arms, it's going to freeze this whole arm, and then your slat's not going to move at all. So you got to be very careful. May not be a bad idea to just remove the part and glue it first. But you can see by adding washers where you need to. This isn't rocket science. I just put them where it needed to be. I added, you can see right here, I added one on this side. And you can see how that helped get rid of a whole bunch of play where the Z-bend was. It just eliminated the extra space that it had. So you just use these washers really where you need to put them to get the play out of the whole system. To demonstrate what I did with the carbon blocks, you'll notice that the slat moves. I went ahead and pulled this linkage off just to sort of show you. There really wasn't a defined place where these slats went forward and stopped. They just sort of hung here at the end and just sort of floated around, which could create some asymmetry and lift from one side to the other. So what I did was, is taking a carbon block, like I did right here, and you can see the shape of it. I just went ahead and glued it right on, and that allows the slat to actually have a defined stopping point. And you can see right there where it stops and locks into place. This slat actually now has a limit. So these blocks are actually act like travel limiters. They only let the slat go so far forward. And now you have a stopping point. I only used the block on the outboard here and here. I didn't use it on the middle one. And then on the inboard slot slat, I used it on this one and on this one. Again, not on the middle. So you need two for here, and then two on the other side, and four on the other side for the other two slats. What happens is now when this arm pushes forward, okay, it now locks here and it locks here, or it reaches a stopping point, a defined stopping point. So there's a defined stopping point now when the slat is closed. There's now a defined stopping point when the slat is fully extended. And that goes a long way to really setting this thing up correctly without worrying about the slat floating at the end and having an asymmetry of lift on one side of the wing from the other. Here's another angle of the carbon flap slat stopper, and you can see how nicely it stops the slat from moving. You can see how it engages nice and secure there. You can see the little piece of wood that I put there just to help keep it in place. I literally just CA'd that in place and in position. And it definitely does a really nice job in stopping that slat into a fixed position to make sure that the slats on both sides of the airplane stop at exactly the same place, so you get the exact same lift from both wings. Now here's another angle just showing you multiple actuators and multiple hinges moving all together. You can see here that it's actually kind of a poetry in motion once you get it working right. And you can see those slat stoppers with the wood supports there that just kind of keep them in place. How nicely they work and how they all lock into position, or at least have a stopping point to go to. Now one thing I noticed regarding only the inboard slat, where the push rod actually comes up against it, as you can see, I changed one screw right here to a flat beveled screw. And I took this piece of plastic off right here, beveled it, so this screw was actually flush with the plastic instead of sticking up and out like this one. Because what I found happened was when this thing went full extension, a lot of times the rod would bind right on that screw sticking out. So I found it a good idea to just put a beveled screw there so the rod no longer interfered with it. Now, in addition, when I added this washer right here, it helped alleviate that problem a little bit, but this is the one place where I decided to put a flat beveled screw. I actually tapered and beveled the plastic on this this arm right here so that thing would countersunk and be flush, and so it wouldn't interfere and bind with this push rod here. Overall, the slat system on this airplane really actually functions quite nice. Once you get all the slop out of it, you get all the play out of it, you tweak it, you add some stoppers to the two outboard hinges, it now has a place to stop. The system works real well. It helps the plane actually take off and land much slower. It's a real good system. Well, again, once you get it all tweaked. Now, this isn't really total rocket science. Now, using the washers and using the carbon blocks really help out tightening the screws. Once you get all the play out of it, then you go ahead and you start adjusting the length of your rods. In some instances, depending on what you have, you may need to take a little bit of the bend out of the rod, or put the rod, or maybe put a little more of a bend in it. Probably ultimately when they designed this thing, they probably should have, instead of trying to use one servo for everything, they probably should have put one servo out here, back here somewhere, to drive the outboard slat, and then have one servo here to drive the inboard slat and the flap. But they try to get away with using one, and it does work once you tweak it. Now, every airplane is going to be a little bit different. These bell cranks, rods, and everything may be glued in differently. There may not be play in one. One may have play in them. There may be play here. There may not be play here. So you really have to use the washers and the things that I used where they're needed. So each airplane is probably going to be just a little bit different. But the basic idea of using the carbon blocks as a travel limiter, using washers to eliminate the play in the Z-bends, in this push rod, and even you can see right here, I actually used two for this clevis. You can see I needed it right there because this one in particular had so much play to it. Now it hardly has any, and I only used one on the other side because putting another one in there made it too tight. So you're going to use these washers really only as needed. And you can see all the washers I used for that assembly right there. So, but once you use your carbon blocks, once you put your washers in, use a little bit of CA on the holes where you need them and get all the play out of it, then you start adjusting the lengths of your rods. You also want to check the throws of your main servos to make sure that this servo horn is in the same position as that one is. Now, they can't all always be the same all the time, but when that one's standing up, this one here should be standing up. So the two flap and slat servos should really move in unison. They should move pretty much together. And then from there, you adjust the length of your rods. Now, the flap rod does have a little bit of play in it. I noticed that it moves and flexes a bit. It's a long kind of bent rod here. But, you know, it really didn't seem to affect the performance of the plane. The plane seemed to fly fine with it. The flaps extended, and it seemed to work real well. When it comes to operating these slats, the way that I set it up on my radio, I use this three-position switch, but I use it a little bit differently than I normally would. When I fly the plane and I operate the slats, I only have two positions that I use, and I don't have a slowdown feature in them. The only positions I used are fully retracted and fully extended when I'm flying the airplane. I don't use an intermediate point generally because the slats seem to float. They just sort of drift around and don't seem to find the right place. So the way I operate my airplane is when I have the switch in the middle position, you can hear that there's no noise of the servos. The servos are not actually stalled out. Whereas when I'm at full travel, just because of the complexity of the mechanism, when they're fully retracted, they're stalled out and they're buzzing a little bit, which you really don't want to have it running that way for too long because you can overheat the servos. When they're in the neutral position, there's no noise. When you go full extension, they also reach their limit as well, and the servo is kind of stalled out. That's really just due to the nature and the complexity of the slat system. That's how I'm operating mine. So when I taxi out, I just leave it like this. When I'm ready to take off, I go ahead and I extend them fully, and then I get my lift for takeoff and landing and so forth. And when I'm at cruise flight, just zooming around, I leave them fully retracted the way you see them here. So the intermediate position on the switch, I leave them like this just to give the servos a break when the airplane is on the ground only. The airplane only flies for about 3 to 4.5 minutes, and then you have to land. So basically I'm flying around with this thing with the slats fully retracted And the servo does stall a little bit, but there's a lot of cool airflow over it, keeping it nice and cool. And it's not really going to put that much drain on the system in 3 to 4 minutes. So, and then when you're landing and taking off, it's only just for a few seconds. You have them in this position, fully extended for takeoff and landing. So I found that this way works really great. I couldn't really get the flaps to fully extend and the slats to fully extend and fully retract without the servo stalling out, because again, the mechanism is so complex, it was just hard to do it that way. You can run these any way you want. This way has worked really well for me. Again, the intermediate position, as you see here, is just to give the servos a break. I operate with them fully extended for takeoff and landing, fully retracted once again for flying around. And usually after landing, when they're fully extended, I usually just put them back to the intermediate position and I taxi in like this. And again, that gives the servos a break. Anyway, guys, I hope this helps you out to get your slat system going. They take a little bit of tinkering, but it is worth it. It operates nicely once you get all the bugs out of it. And I've just had a good time flying it with like this. And it's just a very good system once you get all the bugs out. One more item to note when you are setting your flap and slat system up. Here's a quick look at the slat and flap actuator. You can see it's just three bell cranks on a push rod. These are pre-manufactured at the factory. And one thing I notice is that when they set these up at the factory, they cut the end of the, I guess it's just a regular screw that they use, and they cut the end of it off. You can see there's no way to adjust it. And one thing you want to be careful of as you're setting up yours is to make sure that one of them is not moving. And I noticed that one that I got, this one, actually the middle one here, was actually moving on here, not in conjunction with the rest of them. All three of these bell cranks should be locked in and not move at all. But I did find that this middle one is moving. So if you have a source of play going on somewhere and you can't figure out what it is, it quite possibly could be like this one, where you can see this middle one is moving. It's actually sliding on that shaft because they didn't tighten it up enough here. So if you have this problem, just get a hold of Banana Hobby. Just tell them to send you another one. And you do have to pull these plastic pieces out and just sort of replace the rod. But there's really no way to fix it other than to just replace the whole thing with one that's not actually slipping. For those of you that have an extra channel on your radio for the Phantom here, in particular an eighth channel like the Futaba AJ here, and you want to separate your rudder steering, okay, your rudder control with your nose wheel steering, and actually be able to trim them separately when you're on a runway. And I found with this airplane in particular, it's really useful to have that because it has pull-pull kind of cables and rods to steer the nose wheel. And sometimes it doesn't quite center all the time, and I find myself sort of fighting the steering on the ground. And then, of course, if you trim your rudder to get your plane to steer straight on the ground, now you're trimming your actual physical rudder on the airplane, which aerodynamically causes a yaw there. So you notice here what I have is I have my steering set up. So if I turn my rudder, you see my rudder and my nose wheel steering working in the same direction, in the proper direction. And if I trim my rudder, which you'll see back here on the back of the airplane here, I'm trimming my rudder, but my nose wheel is not moving, as you can see. So this allows me to trim just my rudder without messing with my nose wheel. I also set up the VR knob right here, okay, to act as a steering or a tiller trim for my nose wheel. And you notice it trims my nose wheel, but it doesn't mess with my rudder in flight. So I can taxi down the runway. I can go ahead and I can turn this knob right here and trim my airplane to taxi straight on the ground without affecting my rudder. Also, this switch is generally kind of useless in flight because it's really hard to reach it and do anything with it. So it works perfect as a nose wheel steering trim. Anyway, guys, the following steps here, I'm going to show you real quick how to set this up on your F4 Phantom. Now, the first thing you want to do is separate your rudder and your nose wheel servos. Normally, they're connected to a Y harness in a lot of these jets, these EDF jets, and they go into channel 4. So you want to unplug them. Again, put your rudder channel for your physical rudder into channel 4, or your rudder channel. And in this case, I'm using channel 8 for the nose wheel steering because that's the last remaining channel that I have. So I'm going to go ahead and put the nose wheel steering into my aux channel, and again, in this case, it's channel 8. So now they're separated. Now that we have the rudder servo plugged into the rudder channel, which is number 4, and we have the nose wheel steering servo plugged into the aux channel, aux 2, which is channel 8, we're going to go into the menus here. And we're going to change around a few things. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to actually go to page 3. And quickly, we're just going to assign the nose wheel steering to something. Now, what we're going to want to use to move it ultimately is going to be this VR knob for steering. And you notice it doesn't steer it right now. So what we're going to do is we're going to go down to channel 8, which is where we have our nose wheel steering plugged into. And we're going to assign it the VR knob instead of one of these trim switches. So as we move it to VR, now we've actually assigned it to the VR knob. So as I turn this thing, we now have some nose wheel steering, but it's still not linked yet to the rudder. This rudder stick is right now only moving just the rudder, and we need to link them together now. So we back out of that menu. We're going to go over to programmable mixing menu, and we're just going to select one, number 1, because we're going to make a programmable mix. And once we get in here, what we're going to do is we're going to assign, and I had already put these in here, so I'm actually going to clear these out so you can see what this looks like. The mix is inhibited, trims off, some switches are selected, and the most important thing we're going to do first before we do anything is go to master and assign it rudder, and use our plus and minus keys for that. And then our slave channel is going to be aux 2, channel 8, which is our nose wheel steering. So again, we go down there, use our plus and minus keys and select those. So the master is rudder. Slave is aux 2 or channel 8 for our nose wheel steering. Once we've done that, now it's safe to actually activate the mix. So we go up here to the mix, and instead of inhibiting it, we're going to activate it and turn it on. The trim, we're actually going to put that off, okay, and make sure it stays off. The reason we don't want trim activated is because if I move my rudder trim, it will also turn my nose wheel steering, which I don't want it to turn that. I only want this trim running or trimming just the physical rudder. Then we're going to go down to switch, assign a switch to this function, which doesn't really matter because we're going to leave it on null anyway, but switch F is the training switch, which spring loads off. And we don't want to assign a switch because if I flip the switch, then it would turn your nose wheel steering off, which you really don't ever want to do. So. And then the switch position is either on, up, down, or null. So we're just going to leave that in at null. So there's no switch that will actually shut our nose wheel steering off. Now, once this is all done, we now have to get our nose wheel steering, our nose wheel linked with our rudder control. And the way that we do that is we just go right up here to where it says rate. And you notice as I move this left and right, it actually highlights left for left, and right for right. So we have to highlight the correct one, and I'm going to show you exactly how this works. I'm going to go left rudder first, left turn, and I had already done this on mine, so I kind of know where it goes. You may have to go plus, as you can see here, or you may have to go minus, depending on which way yours is set up. So what I'm going to do is go plus 90. You can see the nose wheel is actually turning right now. I'm going to go all the way up to 90%. You may need to go to 50% or 70% or 100% depending on how much travel you want. So now I've linked my nose wheel steering servo to my rudder for left turning only. For right turning, it's not set up yet, but you notice it highlighted the lower block. So I already know that that's plus 90 because I already fooled with this. As I hold that button down, look at my nose wheel turning to the right. I'm going to bring it all the way up to 90%. Again, depending on how much travel you want, you can set this up for personal preference. Now I have steering in the proper direction and everything works really nicely. Now, a couple of snags you might run into, I'm going to go ahead and back out of here and show you a couple things. You notice now our mix is set up. Rudder is the master, aux 2 is the slave channel. So rudder is channel 4, aux 2 is channel 8. As we know, channel 8 is actually hooked up to our nose wheel steering. So I'm going to back off on out of here. And a couple things we may have to mess with, and I had to do this on mine, but I noticed that as I moved my stick, my nose wheel, actually for whatever reason, my nose wheel or my VR trim, I don't remember which one, wasn't moving the nose wheel in the right direction. So you may have to actually reverse your nose wheel steering channel, okay? Because we already know our rudder's working in the right direction, our physical rudder in the back of the airplane. So we may need to reverse this, and I did have to reverse that channel, and that's what gave me the proper steering. So it's real important to just remember that reverse might throw you off. You may be steering right with your rudder, but your nose wheel may be going left. It's a combination of the reverse function and the plus or minus menu, that is plus or minus settings that are actually all the way back here at the programmable mixing, the rate plus or minus. So you have to fool with those to get it correct depending on your airplane. Now, the other thing you're gonna have to mess with probably too is your sub trim. And you'll see here as I go into the sub trim, all I'm gonna have to mess with really is my rudder, okay, which is channel four, to get that trimmed and neutralized for your physical rudder in the back of the airplane. And then your nose wheel steering. So to get your nose wheel steering really set up correctly, the best thing to do is to set your VR knob. You notice now my VR knob still works as a trim, like we saw in the beginning. It's still turning my nose wheel. And as I move my rudder, it also works to steer the airplane. And as I move my physical rudder trim, it no longer affects my nose wheel. So it's really nice how this all functions. So, but to set up your nose wheel steering and to get it all centralized, just get your VR knob right there in the middle, okay? And then physically look down the center line of the airplane and look at it from underneath. And when you scroll all the way down here to to your aux 2 or your channel 8, you now can press plus or minus, and that will actually trim your nose wheel, which is actually what it's doing right now. I have mine on 52. You just have to trim that so it's as close to the center as you can. And with mine at 52, my nose wheel is straight down the center. My knob is right in the center. And the beauty of that is now as I move my knob, I should have an equal amount of right trim and an equal amount of left trim. If you don't have your knob in the center when you adjust this trim, you may have an unequal amount of steering to either side. All right, guys, you can see the end result of programming your radio this way. You can notice I have right rudder and nose wheel steering, left rudder and left nose wheel steering. They're all linked together. But as I drive around on the ground, I can trim my nose wheel steering with this knob independently without messing up my flight rudder, my rudder for flight. And while I'm flying, I can also now trim my rudder. You can see I'm going full rudder without affecting my nose wheel steering on the ground. This really is a great way to fly. It's not necessary. You know, the manufacturer set it up with a Y harness from your rudder, connecting your rudder and your nose wheel steering. So you only need one channel to operate, but trying to sometimes trim that and set it up so they're both nice and straight is kind of tough to do. So if you have the extra channel for it, you make your rudder your master channel. You make your nose wheel steering servo your slave servo. And with just a little bit of programming here, you can have the whole thing working real nice, everything steering in the proper direction with individual trims. So you can trim it on the ground with your knob, trim it in flight with your steering without affecting each other. It really is such a great way to fly. Check out this video also on RC Informer. I'll probably do a separate video of this. So if you guys want to check out the video independent of this F4 Phantom video, you'll be able to check it out. All right, guys, that pretty much concludes this video on the building and setup of the LX Models F4 Phantom 2 from Banana Hobby. As you can see from that video, there's a little bit of tweaking that you can do to the flaps and slats to get this thing set up going nice. But once you get those things up and rolling, you got a heck of a nice airplane here. It really is a very well-built, very tough airplane. Builds relatively easily for the most part, flies really nicely, has good habits, very scale-like. You just got to get the slats and the flaps tweaked to operate correctly. Now, there are guys that are just gluing the slats in place and not using them at all, just using the flaps, and that's one way to go. The plane is probably faster that way. The landing speed is probably a little quicker, but I've seen a few guys out there flying it like that. But if you really want to get the flaps and slats set up working right, if you kind of follow the guidance in here, you know, you can get them rolling properly and getting them operating properly. You just have to You just have to spend a little time on them and tweak them right. The rest of the airplane is relatively a no-brainer. As long as you get the CG set right, this thing flies like a champ. You gotta love the looks of the skull and crossbone on the tail. The whole VF-84 Jolly Roger Squadron paint job on this thing. It's just simply an awesome jet from that Vietnam War era. LX Models really did a nice job on it. Again, once you get the flaps tweaked and the slats tweaked, it's just such a stellar airplane. Anyway, guys, thanks for checking out this video on the LX Models F4 Phantom 2 from Banana Hobby. Thanks for checking out RC Informer, and as always, we'll see you next time.
Just simply smooth, guys. Just can't beat the way this thing flies.